the sweep here, so you see the front of the train and the back of the train.
And here we can see the other two other tracks, so they're coming back as well.
I can hear it now. And they did that just basically the narrow gauge to be able to get through the canyons. When you go on the Durango Silverton, there could be places where you're sitting on the car and you can look out the door through the steps and see the water below you 1,000 feet. So it just goes right along the canyon floor. But they've been doing that for over 100 years, so I guess it's safe.
We did it.
I enjoy the heck out of it. It's wonderful. So what we're doing right now is we're climbing up through the, we left the plains as we started climbing up out of Denver. So that those plains went clear back to Iowa and Chicago, Illinois area. We're now going through the mountainous areas, obviously. We're in the tunnel district, and we have, used to be 30 tunnels through here, and they dug all these back in the late 1800s by pickaxe and dynamite. You'll see some of the corners have created the tunnels a little bit. So this is an old mound. A lot of what we're seeing here is ponderosa pine. That's this cottonwood tree on the left there. These are aspen trees. That whole grove is one family. They're all interconnected probably. They have a mother tree in the aspens that kind of directs what to do. Do they want to send up more shoots for more trees, or do they want to kill some of them off? There's a wild horse in the front.
Sorry.
Just kidding. It is a horse. But one of the largest organisms in the world is an aspen grove, those trees, that type of tree, down in southern Colorado. So they're one family intertwined. We've had a very wet spring this year. If you can see the wildflowers off to the left, that's very unusual for this time of year. Things are usually pretty dry up in here, but it's just beautiful now. We've had a wonderful spring.
So the aspen tree is connected to the woods?
Yes.
And is it that one?
Yeah, in the fall those turn yellow, so this is a fun trip in late September when the leaves turn, they're an annual tree, deciduous trees, so they shed their leaves in the winter. This is Gross Reservoir up to our right. A month ago there was a significant head of water coming over that spillway. Part of the Denver Water Board, a lot of the water that we get for consumption in Denver comes from the western side of the divide. And I don't know if you understand what the Continental Divide here in the United States, it kind of cuts north to south, and it's a drainage. Anything on the other side of the divide goes to the Pacific, all the watershed here goes to the Atlantic, or actually down into the Gulf. The reservoir, off to our right, you see a little bit of it here, and then as we get a little further out. So here's some more aspen trees right here. Now you can see the reservoir. You see it again. Denver Water wants to increase the height of this reservoir, the dam, by 110 feet to store more and more water. So to do that, they'll have to build a brand new dam in front of the curb. So you'll see a lot of dead trees over there, and that's what that's all about. The forest was really old, it was over 100 years old, and lodgepole pines are elderly when they're in their 80s, so it was dry, they were old, easy. after a bad one. I do that all the time too. There's a little community of Pine Cliff.
It's Pine Cliff.
Back in the mid-1900s, this was where people had their summer cabins to get away from the heat in Denver. And now they have a lot of year-round residents here.
Well, but I didn't get it from over. And I didn't want to double down.
So that is during winter times. Okay.
No, this is
it's not horrible up here. And people do live here year round, so it's a little cooler up here than Denver, but it's doable.
Yeah, I could meet him.
You really see the blue and the blue spruce in here.
It's probably a good thing.
I wonder how common it is to see it.
That's good.
Well, I'm asking all the questions.
So, interestingly enough, we had the pine beetles that killed off all the lodgepole pine. On the western side, and there's some lodgepole on this side too, we'll see a little later. But the spruce were impervious to that particular bug. But every tree has some critter that will kill it. They had down southwest of Denver, a moth that came in and killed off a bunch of spruce in there. So every tree has an enemy. These wires you see along the edge here, we'll see them all along this route. Those aren't to stop the rocks. They actually have electrical circuits through those wires, and if the rock slide comes down and wipes that fence out, that automatically sends a red signal on the tracks, as well as to the dispatcher in Omaha, who is responsible for all the trains on these tracks, to stop the trains and check out and see what caused those rock fences, as they call them, to pull apart. So, we see it again, but they're all
sure?
Along
yes.
Here. And it's not to stop the rocks, it's just to protect the rocks coming down.
Because it does.
Also on the other side, about 1976, they transplanted moose. Walden, Colorado. They had 24 moose they planted there. Here's some beaver ponds here, actually. That herd is over 2,000 animals big now, or large in quantity.
Wow.
They've actually come over the divide on this side, so they've had moose sightings over here. But they're not indigenous to this area. So I have a problem with it. The Game and Fish Department did it. Because their whole job is to provide hunting animals, so that's their living. But moose are kind of a gnarly, angry animal, especially cow with a calf in the spring. You don't want to be around them. And I'd rather be around bears than I would moose. Bears are much, much more skinny. And we don't have the grizzly bears down here like we have in Wyoming. The grizzly are meat eaters. Black bears we have here are vegetarians, unless you get between them and their cubs, then they can be kind of mean. They're pretty easy animal to be around. This is Pactolus right in here. When I was a kid, we used to come up here ice skating. Originally, this was a pond that the Denver and Rio Grande Railroad cut ice off of in the wintertime, and they had a big cinder block building there with sawdust. They'd store the ice there, and then when the refrigerator cars came across carrying fruit from the West Coast, they'd stop in here and ice them up. They weren't mechanically refrigerated, they were ice chests on either end. They put the big ice blocks in. This whole area has been reclaimed. Back in the 1800s, you can see piles of rocks in here. They used to come in.
And once I do so, I will make a waiting list. I will make an announcement once I have started a waiting list, but you can expect that to happen quite soon after my first call. First call for lunch should be around 12 o'clock noon. Again, we'd like to thank everyone who joined us for breakfast and enjoy the rest of your morning.
So here's on our right coming out some of those lock fences, and you can see the insulators on the poles there for the electrical circuits. I just made it up. It makes a good story. South Platte? No, this is South Boulder Creek. South Platte's way south in here. In fact, when we left Denver, we crossed the South Platte, but there's a big drainage area over there that has streams like this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, something's killing these trees off. I wonder if that's a lot there.
It's like a dream bed. Yeah. That painted BW women in the
paper. Oh, no. On that tree.
Oh, no. On the tree. Across the yard there. Never mind.
See an oil train going by on the left? Well, we're going by it. Get a lot of oil out of North Dakota, South Dakota, and Montana, called the Bakken oil fields. So what they do is the federal governing body, FAR, is making new regulations for what kind of cars they can, tank cars that they can transport this oil in. They have to be double skinned, so thick. But it's a big controversy going on right now. Used to be a lot of coal came down on this route out of the Grand Junction area. Coal is on the decline because of the regulations for the power plants here in the States. So they're going to natural gas. We'll see a lot of natural gas Grand Junction before we get off the train. But the coal traffic used to be maybe 20 trains a day,
yes.
And then get 9 trains a day that comes out. But we're starting to see it increase.
Yeah, mine was
kind
of twitchy.
So now with the price of oil really going down,
I'm sure we could have asked.
We're seeing a decline in the exploration of the Dakotas for the new oil
I can go back there and help him.
No. I think he wants to sleep for 20 minutes by himself.
I think we just passed Netherland and I have my back to it. I'm about to come to it.
No, we were planning on going to get Bethany at like 11:15 to get in line for lunch.
I like these summaries.
For it. So you're going to stay in line for 45 minutes?
11:45?
Oh, I think they said noon.
It takes like 10 minutes to get back there.
Yeah, it does. I understand.
Real train nuts, real train geeks. They get so excited about trains they start pulling their time. I'm not quite that bad, but getting close. The physics of how a train rides on the rails just interests the heck out of me. I mean, each wheel touching the rail touches it with about the area of a 25 cent piece of U.S. quarter. Which is about like that. And so you have two sets of four wheels on a car carrying a few hundred tons. And amazing. They stay on the track. You know, you've got the rails got a certain curve to it, and the wheel has a certain curve to it to keep it going down the rail. And it has a small flange on the wheel, but it's not very big. But it's that curve, the interface of the curve, not having much friction,
keeping the friction
low, it's a science, and they still are working that issue. Yeah.
It's an issue of friction.
And they have a big seminar every other year, but they just just got it made. People from all over the world come to this thing. It's called the Wheel Rail Interface. Oh, yeah. You can set your watch by it. You don't have to go here. The railroad guys say if you take all the railroads in the country, throw them up in the air, watch them come down. Everything comes down, and Amtrak comes down about 8 hours later. And it's not Amtrak's fault. Right now, we're on Union Pacific tracks. They don't own the rails here in the west. In the northeast, they own their own rails. They're on time. They're almost like European. But out west here, they're at the beck and call of the